according to a Reuters dispatch. General Douglas MacArthur has ordered all women and children in Manila to evacuate the seacoast and move to areas inland. Dutch East Indies has just declared war on Japan. Costa Rica in South America has also just declared war. A bulletin from New York. Mayor Fiorello H. LaGuardia, Civilian Defense Director, announced tonight he had ordered all Japanese nationals in New York City to remain in their homes until their status is established by the federal government. At the same time, John Colling, Superintendent of Operations for TWA, acting on instructions from the Civil Aeronautics Authority, issued an order prohibiting TWA's planes from carrying any Japanese nationals. This order was directed against the special Japanese envoy, Korosu. We take you now to Hollywood.
One Man's Family, brought to you by Tenderleaf Tea. Dedicated to the mothers and fathers of the younger generation and to their bewildering offspring. Tonight we present Chapter 10, Book 40, entitled A New Incident in the Matter of Irene Franklin. Right now, as you make your holiday plans, here's news you'll be glad to get. Your grocer now has his Yuletide supply of Tenderleaf tea balls in the holiday wrapping. Bright, gay, colorful gifts to convey the good cheer of the season. They'll be featured through December in this festive dress, the most popular tea balls in America for the most popular days on the calendar. Get some for gifts. They're extremely appropriate. For the essence of fine tea is its warm, good fellowship, the very spirit of Christmas. And in Tenderleaf tea balls, it reaches a peak. They're made with tasteless filter paper that keeps your tea perfectly clear and gives you just the delicate flavor of the tiny, new, top tea leaves. This year, give Tenderleaf brand tea balls in a special holiday wrapping. Inside and out, it carries the heartiest good wishes of the season. Inexpensive, practical, and always welcome. Ask for Tenderleaf tea balls, America's largest selling tea balls, in the holiday wrapping. Of Irene Franklin, there's something rather unorthodox in the atmosphere. Mother Barbara feels it, Father Barbara feels it, and even Clifford has indicated it by his actions. Even as a hired hand down on Hazel's Dairy Ranch, he manages to get over to Berkeley, where Irene is a freshman at UC, but he never gets around to bringing her across the bay to see his family, and he certainly doesn't like discussing her with anyone. Mother Barbara, with a hoping for the best, but what can you do with a grown son attitude? Father Barber getting along with Clifford on casual but friendly enough terms, and Clifford tending blindly to his own business, pretending the whole thing doesn't exist. But all the rest of the family is pretending Irene doesn't exist either, because around the holidays, no one wants having any serious difficulties that might spread the strain of the family circle and cloud the holidays. If there's going to be an eventual blow-up over Irene, everyone's keeping his fingers crossed that it won't happen until after the Christmas and New Year's festivities. So why there should be a blow-up, no one seems quite to know. Except that there's that edgy feeling and air of suspense and secrecy. Anyway, this is Clifford, one day a week off from the dairy ranch, and he phoned up that he was going to stop downtown and do a little Christmas shopping before coming out of the family home in Seacliff.
Then he'll be here for dinner, naturally. Yes, he'll eat with us and then go back to Rancher as usual.
Oh, that's going to work out perfectly.
At least it will if he hasn't any other plans. What's that, Hazel?
Well, I forgot to tell you, Mother. I'm planning to take the children and go down to the ranch tonight. That'll give us a long weekend in the country.
I should say it will. What about having kids at school?
Oh, I've already spoken to their teachers. But the nice thing is, if Clifford's going down early, perhaps he can drive us. I don't like driving at night.
Of course he will.
If he hasn't other ideas in mind.
Ideas, indeed.
Well, we'll see when he comes. I thought Claudia was coming in this afternoon.
She'll be home presently. How do you like the way I've rearranged the living room, Hilda?
Mother, you know as well as I do that you're going to have trouble with Father.
That man.
Yes, I know.
Anybody home?
Yes,
in the living room, Jack.
Okay. What's the matter with this house, anyway? Quiet as an empty garret.
Not when you come in, it isn't. Oh, Betty.
Over next door. I don't know what I'm going to do with that girl. Takes her longer to get clean than an elephant should take. Locks herself in the bathroom and stays there and stays there. I think she must wash each pore separately.
Oh, well, she's having fun.
Yeah, but it's getting worse. Honest to goodness, it's getting so I have to start her in the middle of the afternoon just to get her ready to come over here in the evening.
Well, that's just habit.
Yeah, but it's not a good one. What do you think I ought to do about it? You got any ideas?
Jack, how about you and Betty working out your own problem?
Oh, sure.
The business were not interesting. But families have a natural tendency to interfere in young married people's lives, as it is.
Yes, don't leave yourself wide open by asking for suggestions.
No kidding, though. It might get to be serious, mightn't it? Right now, I get a kick out of her fussing in the bathtub and fussing before the mirror and doing up her hair and taking it down and doing it up a different way and changing her stockings 3 or 4 times and trying on 2 or 3 pairs of shoes and slipping in and out of dresses until she gets just what she wants. See what I mean?
But haven't you spoken to her?
Oh, sure. Not very seriously. It's all fun now, and she's got a lot of time on her hands, so it really doesn't matter. But recently, it's getting so she doesn't keep appointments.
And that is sad.
Yeah, and the only reason, because she takes so long getting ready. She really was a lot more efficient when we were first married than she is now.
And you think it's because she doesn't have much to keep her busy all day, and so she's getting into the habit of cluttering, huh?
What else?
Then by all means, see that she has something to do.
What?
Well, if your father wasn't so wrong 2 weeks ago when he recommended children.
Hey, Mom, you too.
Well, that's why marriage was created in the first place. As a foundation for a family. A foundation that isn't built on is a pretty barren affair.
Something started that isn't finished, huh?
Yes, sir.
Doggone it. Those children are a heck of a lot of trouble and worry. Think of the responsibility.
Someday you're going to find out, Jack, that on any account, each human being is going to face more or less trouble and worry, children or no children. And as for responsibility, you can't be either a civilized citizen or a self-respecting human being without accepting responsibility.
In other words, we're born to get it in the neck anyway, so why not go whole hog?
That's one way of putting
it. Hi, Hazel.
Oh, hello, Teddy.
Hiya, Quail.
Hiya, Wolf.
Oh, what kind of language is that?
I believe that's supposed to be the modern boy talking to the modern girl.
Quail?
Sure. Quail, partridge, hen. It's all one for woman.
Yeah, but all men are wolves.
Teddy, that's very young and unsophisticated cynicism.
Well, that's what they're doing.
I suppose you haven't had any experience on your own?
What an odd suggestion.
Uh-huh. Who do you think you're getting?
Anything that Teddy has experienced is both honorable and trustworthy, I'm sure. In any case, none of your affair, young man.
Then that's for you.
Sure. 3 women against me. I know when I'm licked.
Where's Betty?
Oh, she'll be over when she gets her neck washed.
Betty's the washingest person I ever knew. Maybe your mother was frightened by a stack of dirt.
Maybe. Hey, here come Claudia and Nikki.
Huh? How do you know?
I can see the front window reflected in the mirror over the fireplace.
Well, I'll go let them in.
You don't have to. Front door's on the latch. I came in that way.
Oh, by the way, Hazel, I finished all my classes today and got caught up in homework so I can go down to the dairy ranch with you tonight.
Oh, the children will love that, Betty.
Well, maybe you don't think I won't.
Well, if you're coming along to look after them, I think I'll ask Claudia if she won't let Joan and Kenny go along, too.
All right. Margaret's kind of young to run around with the older kids, so it would be nice if she could have Penelope to play with.
What's this about Penelope?
Oh, we didn't hear you at the front door.
Miss Jen.
Hello, Mom. How are you?
Oh, as well as ever.
Put up this
Put your nose is cold. Sure, everyone's there who sticks it outdoors today.
Ooh, refrigerator weather.
Where's Nicky?
Right here. I was hanging up our coats in the hallway.
Well, Mother Barbara, are you recovered from your shopping tour of the other day?
Well, most precious. Oh, I still got a black and blue bruise on my hip where frantic and Christmas-crazed shoppers plowed through me.
Made a first down around right in, huh?
Where's Dad? Well, I don't know. Left right after lunch. But he had business downtown, didn't he? Say what?
Ah, do you suppose it could be monkey business, Mom?
What's that?
With Santa Claus, maybe?
Well, I don't think so. Said only yesterday that if he had to break these holiday shutters at 2 years, there'd never be a present for him.
It must be business, then.
Well, I don't know. He had a kind of Christmassy glint in his eye when he went out to get in the car.
Yeah. Hey, Mom. Then you went down to buy you that tool chest you didn't get for Christmas when you were a shrimp.
Young man, I was never a shrimp.
Okay, and I'll be neat 9-year-old.
Hey, there, Mother Barbara, would you still like a box of tools for Christmas?
I'd love it. Well, father's as apt to bring Mother home a tool chest as he is to bring her a pair of blacksmith anvils. I'm afraid that's true.
I come
home a tool chest as he is to bring her a pair of blacksmith anvils.
When I came down, the if you were here, would I come and tell him?
Me, you said?
What he said. He's up in his studio. I'll be right back.
Oh, what's that all about? I can't think for the life of me.
Then we must compose ourselves and wait.
Apparently. Well, anyway, Claudia, how about letting me have your two young daughters, Joan and Penelope, for the weekend, beginning tonight?
Look here.
You want two of my wild Indians for a whole weekend? That's what I'm asking for. We're going down to the ranch tonight, perhaps to Pippard. And Teddy's going along, so I'll have plenty of help riding his arm. But there's no reason not I'd love having them.
Well, anyway, Joan, for sure. What do you think about Penny, Missy?
She's completely over her sniffles, isn't she?
Sure. I'm still giving her cod liver oil, though.
Well, I suppose Hazel could give it to her.
Yes, I think I might. But if she's not well, the excitement...
Oh, she's well enough. It's just a bother.
And it's settled. We drive down along about 7:30. Anyway, right after dinner.
Missy, would you mind calling up Nurse and telling her?
No, not at all.
Have her pack what's necessary, but tell her we'll be home before they go.
I won't be but a moment.
You're doing your job for yourself. My two with your own three.
Oh, we get along beautifully. And what you call your wild Indians have always been two very sweet and obliging little girls with me.
What do you do? Hypnotize them, Hazel?
Hi, Paul.
Well, gathering with a sea cliff mob, no less.
Oh, what's all this you want to see me about?
Yeah, you've got everyone's curiosity aroused.
Good, isn't that important?
Oh, trying to rat out on us now.
Oh, you said so you'd let me know if you were down here.
But what we want to know is why.
Oh, hello, Paul.
Well, Nicholas, my boy.
Has he developed yet?
He hasn't said a word. Excuse me. Oh, did you get anything?
Oh, quite. Everything will be ready. I waited while you told John and Kenny. They're just back.
Of course they are. Now then, Paul, we're waiting.
The mob is licking its chops.
Is it something you want to talk about alone?
No, as a matter of fact, you asked me a couple of weeks ago to write down a few items concerning characters that you wanted to put up in Hank and Pinky's room.
Oh, that? Well, Paul, have you done it?
Yes. And that's all there is. Just wanted to bring it down to see if it is what you wanted. Yes.
Few items concerning characters?
Yes, we were discussing a few of the points about building character that Hazel wanted to impress on the boys, and she asked me to jot them down.
Why, Paul. Well, this is more by far than I'd hoped for.
All right.
Well, for goodness sake, how about the rest of us getting in on it?
Oh, I should say so. Here, Paul.
Go on, Paul, read it.
Very well, I will. This is it. To mold character. To want to mold a man to good is not enough. First, there must be a passionate desire in that man for self-development. After that, there must be determination. Firm determination and the will to do. He must not only want to develop character, but he must do it. He must train his habit of thought and his habit of action. He must develop the habit of thinking clean thoughts and high-minded thoughts. He must develop the habit of putting evil out of his mind. He must develop good physical habits, habits of exercise, habits of work, habits of graciousness, of courtesy, of friendliness. The physical and mental habits he forms now in his youth will mold the man he will be tomorrow. Form the habit of facing each problem as it comes up. Don't put off or delay a difficult task. get the feeling that you are not a free agent until the task is done. Learn to do each job as it reveals itself, for if you do, you will be one who dominates his job and not dominated by it. And you will discover the more you do, the more you will be able to do. You will outdistance other men by leaps and bounds, men who are hindered and handicapped by their bad habits. That which will be difficult for others to accomplish will be simple for you. Then, too, remember the good things of life. Learn to find the beauty in music and art and literature and in a precious stone and in the work of the goldsmith and the silversmith. However, do not affect a taste for what you do not appreciate, but strive for a glimmering of understanding. Try to keep your mind sensitive and your taste sharpened. Enjoy all the sensations of life, but never dull them with overindulgence.
Oh, I think it's true.
Yeah. Can I have a copy? I wouldn't mind building a little character myself in my spare time.
Well, thank you, Mom.
But there's one thing you emphasize that I never thought about much before. Habit. According to you, the habits you form determine the kind of person you're going to be.
Man's life is concerned entirely with his natural functions and with his habits.
How about it, Nicky? Huh?
I believe that. Habit determines your getting up and your lying down, where you eat, what you eat, and how you eat.
Well, I suppose habit decides whether I'll date a tall, dark young man or a short, fat one tonight.
Well, if you think it won't, you've got another thing coming. And more than that, your habit of modest and decent thought will likely cause you to choose a pretty decent young man.
Well, that's habit?
It isn't anything else.
Hey, I don't want to break this up, but I'd better go back over home and see what's happened to Betty.
There you are. The habit of looking out for his wife.
All gone right. A darn good habit. Wives like Betty don't happen every day.
You coming back?
Oh, sure, Ma. Soon as I round up the mermaid.
About time Crimp showed up, too, isn't it?
We didn't say just when he'd be here.
Well, if he's doing his Christmas shopping, there's no telling when he'll get in. The way the cars are.
No, thank you. We don't want it flirty yet. We just want to look around. Thanks.
But, Clifford, you shouldn't have brought me to a place like this.
What the heck? My family's been buying gifts in this jewelry store ever since I can remember.
I don't want you to buy my Christmas present.
Oh, I mean.
No, really. I mean it, Clifford. You're doing all you should do right now.
Look, Miss Irene Franklin, do you or do you not want to be picked up and shaken for your success?
By you, it would be heaven.
Well, it's likely to happen in writing in public if you don't lay off the kind of talk you do.
I'm just trying to be sensible, Claire. I don't need an expensive Christmas present.
No. There you go.
No, listen. The way it is with us, I'd treasure a Christmas card with your name on it just as much as... That's anything you could buy in
life. You're pretty doggone sweet. You know that.
Yeah. You know how I feel about you.
Something to look at, too. Even if you are only a college freshman.
Oh, you say that to all the girls.
A bit more often to you.
I say that to me.
Yeah. And now we're just going to kind of swirl around and look at things.
Oh, no.
Hey, not buy anything. Just look.
Because you'll get me to say something beautiful, and then on Christmas you'll give it to me.
Oh, I'm reading my mind again.
Don't you understand, Claire? I love your generosity. That's what's so wonderful about you. You'd give anyone you liked everything you have.
Sure I would. If you were kind of little, curly, and dark, and your name was Irene Franklin.
But you just mustn't. Oh, please be good, and buy me a pair of silk stockings for Christmas.
Can't even make two pair.
Two pair would be especially sweet. Come on, please. Let's lose this place.
Oh, I get it. I'm a poor man working for $85 a month on a ranch. Poor men aren't supposed to come into nice places like this and buy their own beautiful things.
That's awful silly, Clifford.
Is it?
Yes. When the girl you have in mind doesn't want this silly old stuff, who's that old gentleman over there?
Where?
Over there. Staring at us so hard.
Hey, that's Brad.
It's your father?
Sure.
He's angry, isn't he?
comes. Get ready for the crack up.
Good afternoon, Clifford.
Hello, Dad.
Yes.
Irene, this is my father.
Hello, Mr. Barber.
Yes.
Dad, this is Miss Irene Franklin. You've heard me speak of her often.
Have I, Andy? Good night.
Yes, Mr. Barber.
Believe me when I tell you that Clifford has no business being in a place like this on his cellar. And for you to bring him here is the quickest way I know of bringing his downfall and utter ruin.
Dad.
Hello, Mr. Barber.
Good day to you, young woman. I hope to see you home for dinner, Clifford.
Clifford, he's wrong.
He's been wrong all his life. That's just about the limit. Come on, let's get out of here.
Back from over next door.
Where's Betty?
No, nope, not yet. He's all alone. Well, you can feel he's done his husbandly duty. He's dressed up on it.
He's got his coat collar up around his ears. It must be cold out.
Well, as long as it stays fresh, it's not going to rain.
Quite, and I like this much better.
Oh, me, who doesn't? There he is.
Boy, it's cold enough to freeze globules of mercury.
Hey, I'll bet this is the snappiest day we've had this year.
Come on up to the fire and blow out your ears.
What about Betty?
That woman.
What now?
Oh, she only has to let the polish dry on her nails and slip on her dress and comb out her hair. But don't bother to hold dinner back for her mom.
I guess it's hardly 4 o'clock.
Well, she may make it. I don't know the answer, honest. I don't. I think I'll take your essay on habit and make her wear it around her neck.
Hello. Didn't I just hear the front door again?
Hi, Cliff. Is that you?
No, it isn't, Cliff. It's me.
Why, Henry, what is it? Father, you're going to see it, are you?
Here. Let me help you out of your coat.
Yes. Thank you. Here, sit down here, sir.
Henry, what in the world is this?
Henry, not half an hour ago, I had one of the most disagreeable encounters of my life.
Is that what made you ill?
No, I'm not here. I'm angry.
Well, you're going to make yourself ill if you don't control yourself, Henry.
Carter was home there.
With your brother Clifford and that girl.
What girl?
That freshman girl over in Virginia.
Yes. You saw Irene Franklin?
I did. And do you know where she had Clifford?
Where she had him?
Yes, where she had him. They were in Murray and Webster's.
Jewelry?
Yes, the jewelry. And she was hanging on his arm, looking as though butter wouldn't melt in her mouth.
Hey, were they in there for an engagement ring?
Oh, well, I bet they were.
Huh?
Well, were they or were
they? I don't know what they were in there for. Engagement rings never entered my head.
Why, Father, a boy and a girl in a jewelry store, and you never thought of an engagement ring?
No. I haven't liked that girl from the first moment I heard her name, and today my suspicions have been confirmed.
How dare.
So she had him in the most expensive jewelry store in San Francisco, didn't she? Clifford, who makes $85 a month on her ass, being marched into a place like that by a chit of a girl who apparently has nothing on her mind but what she can get.
But, Dad, do you know that?
Huh?
You just got through saying you didn't know what they were there for.
It was perfectly apparent.
Well, at least I hope you came away without anything to see.
I did nothing of the sort.
Oh, Father, anyway, what did you see?
I went up to them and said very plainly that Clifford had no business in a place like that on his wages, and for her to bring him there was the quickest way I knew to cause his utter ruin.
Oh,
sweet,
Dad.
Huh? It's perfectly true, Henry.
Henry, I think you must have been out of your mind.
Henry, you know just as well as I do that there's something queer about that arrangement.
Well, whether there is or not.
Yes, appeasement. That's what it is, appeasement. Shutting your eyes to what you don't want to see.
Yes, but, Dad, if they did happen to be in there looking at engagement rings, what a terrible thing you did.
Perhaps I'm a better judge of that than you are, Paul.
Perhaps you are.
And let me tell all of you. At least I've seen this young woman.
And what did you see that made you think you had the right to say the things you did?
So you're here?
Yes, I'm here. And I still want to know what you saw in Irene that gave you the right to say the cruel and wicked things you did.
There's something wrong between you and that girl.
There's nothing wrong between Irene and me. Anyway, I'm almost 30 years old. If that isn't old enough to take care of my own affairs, it's time I found out.
Yes.
Let loose on me, Paul. I could say a lot of things, but I think the truth will hurt worse, so here it is. It was my idea to take Irene into that store. I wanted to buy her something expensive, and she wouldn't let me. When we came in, she just insisted that we leave. That she'd much rather have just a pair of silk stockings for Christmas. That's the truth. I hope it gives you a lot of satisfaction to know that you've absolutely ruined any chance of being liked by someone who may be your daughter-in-law someday.
Please, Clifford, don't say any more.
Just one thing more. I'm not asking you ever to see Irene again. But until you've written her a note of apology for what you said this afternoon, I'm not coming back in this house again.
Oh, Clifford.
I'm sorry, Mom, but that's how it is. And now, goodbye.
Take care of that.
some localities, December means snow. In the south, the sun still shines. But north of south, it's the popular month, the month of gifts. Yes, locked doors and whispered conferences are the order of the day. And the barber home is no exception. For instance...
Hey, Teddy.
I'm not here.
Yeah, I know you're not. But let me in anyway.
No, sir. I'm in conference.
Who's with you?
Santa Claus.
Oh, that's all right. He can keep a secret. I want to show you something I just bought.
What is it?
You'll see. Probably you don't want me to shout it out to the whole family here, do you?
Well, all right. But wait until I cover up these gifts.
Okay?
Okay, come on in. Now don't you look at that table. That's a surprise.
Okay, I won't look. You ought to know about this. I came past Mr. Jackson's grocery store. I saw...
Yes, you found them, too.
What?
Tenderloin steam balls in the new holiday wrapping.
Well, yes.
Well, that's what I got. Oh, look, aren't they wonderful? With Christmas colors.
Isn't that some wrapping? Season's greetings. Everybody ought to like these.
Well, just about everybody does. After all, they're the largest selling kind in America.
Well, they should be. Made of a small top TV.
And special tasteless filter paper. Who is it?
Teddy.
Oh, just a minute, Claudia. Don't peek.
All right. I just wanted to tell you that Mr. Jackson has his stock of Tenderloin tea balls and the new holiday wrapping. You better get some out of there because everybody's buying.
Everybody is right. Whoopee!
Yes, grocers everywhere are featuring boxes of Tenderloin tea balls with gay Christmas wrapping. They make a practical, inexpensive, usable gift and one that's always welcome. The most popular tea balls in America for the most popular day in the year. Get some. They're the improved Tenderloin brand tea balls made with tasteless filter paper so that you enjoy just the delicious flavor of the delicate young tea leaves. They come 8, 20, 50, and 100 tea balls to the box in the special holiday wrapping. Ask for Tenderloin tea balls in gift boxes with a season's greeting. You have just heard Chapter 10, Book 40 of One Man's Family, written by Carlton E. Morse, the makers of Tenderloin Tea. Chapter 11, entitled How Long Does It Take a Man to Admit He's Wrong, will come to you next Sunday at this same hour. One Man's Family comes to you through the courtesy of the makers of Tenderloin Tea.
Fleischmann's Fresh Yeast is not only one of the richest natural sources of vitamin B complex, it's the only yeast with added amounts of both vitamins A and D. If you bake at home, vitamins A, B1, D, and G are not appreciably lost in the oven. They go right into the bread. This is the Red Network of the National Broadcasting Company.
More war bulletins from New York. The United Mine Workers of America tonight won a 2-1 decision awarding a union shop in captive mines owned by the country's major steel producers. President's Arbitration Board approved the closed shop for the captive mine. And the bulletin from Washington. The State Department said tonight all other American republics had been informed of the treacherous attack by Japan on the United States and that the United States had received very heartening messages of support from the other American republics. Now here briefly is just a bit of the text from the news report of NBC's reporter in Batavia, Sidney Albright, about the Dutch East Indies declaration of war on Japan. The Battle of the Pacific has started, and the forces have begun attack against the British and American territories, and the English, therefore, so the Netherlands declare themselves at war with the Japanese Empire. For you, the moment of action has arrived. You're being called up with the U.S., British, and Chinese fighting forces to resist Japanese aggression. This is the National Broadcasting Company.